everyone. Thank you all for coming. This is the last Cannes lecture for this year. And we have the pleasure to receive Patrick Killer, who is a British artist who studied at the Bartlett initially and then went on to the RCA. And he was telling us great stories about the RCA in the 80s. So he will probably tell you more, or maybe not. So thank you so much for coming and for coming to share your work with us. And thank you everyone for being here.
Thank you, Mia. I'm going to start by telling you how someone who studied and briefly practiced architecture, how that turned out. And so the beginning of this, these anecdotes, is about 40 years ago, which was 1977. I began to be led astray by a habit that I got into of collecting what I subsequently called found architecture. Although the architecture wasn't lost, but if you can think of these buildings in the same way as you might think of a found object, I think what they had in common. I've only got digital images of two of them, or digitized images of two of them, of which this is the first. If you think of these buildings as architectural examples that were the product not the product of mainstream architecture, and that it was possible or easy or tempting to interpret in a way which perhaps had not been intended by the people who built them or designed them. Which isn't to say that they weren't designed with architectural intent, because I think probably it's quite difficult to design any building without some degree of architectural intent. But they were. This particular building wasn't designed, as far as I know, by an architect. It was probably designed by an engineer. It's a coal hopper. It was a coal hopper. It's not there anymore. It was the coal hopper of the Nine Elms Gas Works, and it stood between Nine Elms Lane and the river, and on the other side of the Nine Elms Lane, this is the north wall. Well, this is the north side of the Nine Elms Lane. On the other side, the south side, was the Nine Elms Gas Works, which had already been demolished when I got down there. Well, I say that. I think I probably first saw this building in the late 60s, because Nine Elms was an area of London to which a certain sort of architectural tourist was attracted. And there were other areas of London like that, particularly Silvertown, where there were similarly large concrete hopper-like structures, one of which survives. Most of Silvertown's gone. Some of it was blown up by Stone. I don't know if he actually blew it up. Some of it was lying around in the wake of Stanley Kubrick's Full Metal Jacket, where part of the gasworks at Beckton was dressed up as Saigon. When he was making the film. I think that's gone. But one of the grain silos, or possibly flour silos, in Silvertown survives because it's listed. It's called Silo D. So if you ever go down to North Woolwich, you'll probably see it. It's to the north side of the road that goes to Woolwich Ferry. Anyway, this Nine Elms was unusual because it was very near the centre of London. Nine Elms is, as you probably know, between Vauxhall Bridge and Battersea Power Station. Most of that area of London was in some sort of industrial use. It was either goods yards or the gas works. There was a brewery. There wasn't much else apart from there was a large concrete warehouse, which I'll show you in a minute. But by this time, the gas works had mostly been cleared away. This was disused. It had been built, I think, in the 50s, as far as I can tell from our wooden survey maps. It wasn't there before the Second World War. It may always have been pink. I don't know whether it was always pink, or whether it was painted pink, either when it was new or later, to make it less unattractive. So gas people thought. And the roof, again, I don't know, I assume that the roof is painted green to make it look like copper. Well, it isn't copper, it's concrete, apparently. The site was squatted later on by a car broker. And then in the winter of 1979 to 80, the building was demolished very slowly with a ball and chain. They couldn't blow it up because it was too near the river. It would have killed all the fish. It's not there anymore. But I took a lot of photographs of it, none of which I really knew what to do with, which this is one. This is not my photograph. You can see it here. This is from the mid-60s, I think, or possibly late 60s. That's the building. That's the Nyalls warehouse, which was something to do with the goods yards, which are here. That's the Nyalls coal store, which was built in the late 60s. I think that opened in 65. So this is a relatively brief period before this was demolished in 1969. After that was built in 1965. And you can see the power station. When all this stuff had been cleared away, well, not all of it, most of it, the gas works and the railway yards, Nyalls Lane was redeveloped for light industrial and distribution uses. There was a very large sorting office, post office sorting office there, and a very large HMSO stationery depot, and a few other things, and light industrial units. And so it was until relatively recently when, until the US Embassy, well, until someone put together a company called Ballymore, an Irish developer, called Ballymore, put together in consultation with the two local authorities, most of this neighbourhood is in Wandsworth. There were two local authorities and various other people, I suspect, and various other corporate interests who are now in the process of redeveloping it. And the centrepiece of this redevelopment was the US Embassy. But the coal hopper was about there, where Richard Rogers practiced, built these flats, which they called River Light, which were the first, as far as I know, the first of the current raft of residential developments to be built in this redevelopment. This funny red block of flats opposite the embassy, that was there, that was built in the 80s. It was always a bit of a joke, it was one of the most ridiculed buildings on the London waterfront, as far as I can remember. It was said that it was designed by a year-out student, because they're London architects were a bit short-staffed, but I don't think that's true. That's what people used to tell me about it. It was designed by someone, a practice that I've never heard of really before or since. And one imagines that the embassy would like to knock it down, but it's a bit difficult. This is another one. This is a cinema in Walthamstow, which I in the mid-70s, I was teaching at the Northeast, what was then the Northeast London Poly School of Architecture. For about 2.5 hours a week, one afternoon a week, I had this little teaching job. And I used to go past this building on the way to the School of Architecture, which was in Forest Road in Walthamstow. And I'd been going past it for quite a long time before I noticed that it was a very odd building. It's a bit like the other one in that its form is determined largely by its function. It's a kind of, this is not functionist architecture, but it's the sort of architecture which is difficult. It's difficult to make the building so that it doesn't somehow betray its function. And when I say that, I'm thinking in terms of the staircases. You can see the staircase. The strange form of the roof, three-shaped roof, is to do with the fact that it's got raised seating and possibly a balcony. These things are the loos, which have been added on, and are somehow reminiscent of plug-in city. except that it, this is from the 1920s or something, and, you know, London cities from the 1960s were not made of plastic, but they are pods of that kind. But it's not like the other building, in that it has architectural pretensions, as you see, is this neoclassical facade at the corner. It's at the corner of Hope Street and Forest Road, which then about half a mile up north from the Walthamstow Central Station. And it's still there, unlike the other one. It's now, I think, a snooker hall. When I was around, it was a pornographic cinema. So much so that I never dared go inside in case somebody saw me. But that's the other one. Anyway, it seems to have been purpose built as a cinema. But this is an old Mussolini map from just after the First World War. And I don't imagine there was much building during the First World War. So, and there weren't very many cinemas before the First World War. So I suspect it's always been a cinema, which is unusual because a lot of early cinemas were not. It was not the first use of the building. Now, after a few, well, in 1970, the next year, there was a very large exhibition in the Hayward Gallery called Dada and Surrealism Reviewed. And there were quite a lot of publications around this exhibition, one of which was an issue of architectural design called Architecture and Surrealism. And this was the first time I learned that the Surrealist movement had any interest in architecture. There aren't really any Surrealist architects, certainly not early on. None of the early Surrealist group in the 1920s were architects, but they did seem to be very interested in architecture, or the built environment, anyway, cityscapes. And I had not encountered this before. And there were a couple of articles on this AD which I was particularly struck by and identified myself in these terms, partly because the Surrealists had a kind of canon of Surrealist sites in Paris, mostly in Paris. Well, there was a particular article about the Surrealist perception of Paris, and I thought, well, I suppose that's a bit like what you're doing. Maybe you should take it a bit more seriously. These slides, this stuff, people who teach at architecture schools, they tend to inflict their enthusiasms on students, especially after the summer holiday. They go off to Tuscany or somewhere and come back and show the students slides of things that they think are interesting or important. And I was doing this with my slide, but I didn't really, it was a kind of side issue to my major goals. But when I got go around. When I came across this Surrealist material, I thought maybe I should take it a bit more seriously. This, for example, this is one of the illustrations in André Breton's Nadia, which is a novel, illustrated with a number of things, including photographs by Jacques-André Boiffard, who was one of the more, well, Boiffard was a medical student who took up photography. And was a photographer for some years before returning to his medical studies. And this is, as you see, the Hôtel des Grands Hommes, which is in the Place du Panthéon in Paris, and is mentioned in the story. So I think Breton writes, my starting point was the Hôtel des Grands Hommes, but I think he was living at the time, but he didn't say that. The statue, interestingly, is Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who is known amongst solitary walkers as the author of the Reveries of the Solitary Walker, and the author of lots of other things. Sadly, Rousseau wasn't there anymore because he melted down during occupation. But that was one of these, that's actually not part of the Surrealist canon of preferred sites in Paris, but it's one of the illustrations in Breton's novel. The novel, or the book rather, that served as my textbook when I subsequently pursued this kind of work, was Louis Aragon's Le Paysan de Paris, or Paris Peasant, as it's known in English. which is a study of two locations in Paris, one of which is the Passage de l'Opéra, which was about to be demolished when he was writing the book, and the other one is the Parc des Buttes Chaumont, which is a park, I think, before the quarry in the suburbs in the 16th, in the, can't remember which arrondissement, northeast Paris, not very far from the Parc de la Villette, which I'll come to in a minute. This is a photograph. This is a double page from Georges Bataille's document. Bataille wasn't a member of the, he wasn't welcomed by the Surrealists. He was kind of, I think they didn't say, well, he wasn't very nice, the Surrealists. The Surrealists didn't seem to welcome Bataille's activities. But there was a kind of quite a lot of overlap, and people who wrote for, this is Bataille's journal, which is called Document, which was published briefly in the, between, I think, 29 and 31. And usually contains something along the lines of this dictionnaire, sometimes it's called dictionnaire critique, and sometimes called chronique, and sometimes both. It's not always alphabetical, I think. This issue included Abattoir. Other issues included Architecture. There's another very interesting entry on Espace. But here, this is quite a good one because you have Abattoir. The abattoirs and La Villette were a place of great interest to the Surrealists for all sorts of quasi-religious reasons. There's a film that you might come across at some point about the abattoirs of La Villette, which was made after the Second World War by Georges Franjou, called Les Sons des Bêtes. This is a photograph by Elie Lothar, who was another, or perhaps the other, noted Surrealist photographer along with Breitbart. I think they had a studio together at one point. He's known for these photographs of the abattoir. He was also a cinematographer. And he photographed Bunuel's Las Urdes, for example, and films for Joris Evans and Jean Parmelin. Now, so that's enough about that. If you're interested in this, you can follow it up, perhaps. But what happened to me was that as a result of this, I addressed myself to what was then called the Department of Environmental Media, the RCA, as Bill just mentioned. And became a student, postgraduate student, to see where this would take me. And very quickly I ran out of examples of fine architecture. There was a limit to how many of these things I could find. I didn't really know what to do with them. I spent quite a lot of time trying to improve my technique as a photographer, with limited results, but eventually I had the idea that this might lead into filmmaking. I don't know why I thought it would lead into filmmaking. I think possibly because the way that these images got presented was that one would show an image and talk about it rather than the way that I'd just been doing. And that seemed to be something which could... there was an idea of text and image, and that seemed to be something which would be perhaps most at home in a film. I started to make film footage and was immediately horrified at the low definition of 16mm film. In those days, 16mm film was kind of affordable for students if you didn't use too much of it. I remember the first roll of 16mm monochrome. First roll I ever exposed. I got it back from the lab and I looked at it and I thought, oh God, there must be something wrong with the camera. You know, what's wrong with it? It's covering all these dots. You must be out of focus. But it wasn't out of focus, it was perfectly all right. It was just that I was used to the definition of 35mm color slides, which are firstly about four times the size of a 16mm film frame, and secondly, they're not prints. They're the camera original, so you don't have the loss of detail or the loss of definition that you get when you make a print from a magazine. This was a bit of a setback, but it was unleashed, this project. This is not from a film, this is a photograph. not a very well exposed photograph, not very nice weather. This is, I happened to be in Paris in the summer of 1980, and driving down the road, just as this building, which was not the abattoirs of La Villette, but the cattle market of La Villette, which also appears in Franchi's film, was being demolished. Not all these buildings, the sheds, the cattle sheds were designed by engineer called Baltar, and some of them were preserved and were converted. This site was in the process of being converted into a park, the Park of La Villette. The Park of La Villette was being converted according to a design by Bernard Schumi. Bernard Schumi was one of the authors of one of the articles in the architectural design issue, Architecture and Surrealism. So this was of some interest to me. And I happened to arrive there by chance, just at the moment, well, just not the moment, but just on the afternoon, they were demolishing the building, this building. And took a photograph. Can you turn the light on? And this subsequently became part of the first text and image work that I ever made, which was a collection of about 21 monochrome color slides with a spoken narration. And subsequently, not very long after that, I was on a train going out of Houston, and I noticed this interesting landscape. I thought it was an interesting landscape, which struck me as a good camera subject. And I subsequently visited this place, which is near, it's at the back of something called Lion Park Avenue. I subsequently visited it on my bike, and I discovered not only was there these allotments in the back of these houses, I think what attracted me was it looks as if it's a bit of Yorkshire or something. It's actually in Harrow, not Harrow, Wendell. So I thought that's interesting. But when I got there, I discovered not only was there the allotment landscape, but also this extraordinary footbridge, which you can see a bit of here, which is possibly the longest and most extensively articulated railway footbridge, certainly that I've ever come across. And it occurred to me that this would be quite an interesting way to make a film, in that the problem with making a film with architecture in it is that a two-dimensional rectangular image doesn't actually tell you very much about architectural space. But the bridge was almost the right shape to be a two-dimensional perspective image. And I subsequently made a film, half of which consists of walking the camera across the bridge, occasionally stopping at the quarter landings. I'd stop at the quarter landing and do a kind of panorama, just to look at the view. And also, you could peep over the parapet. The parapet was just high enough to see over, just low enough to see over. And that was the way I made the first film. I wrote a rather embarrassing fictional narrative, which I'll spare you. And I was off, really. The original project was the Found Architecture, which involved something the surrealists called frisson, that kind of went by the board for a bit while I became what used to be called an experimental filmmaker. Now people talk about artist filmmaker, because these films weren't particularly experimental. They were rudimentary, but they weren't really experimental. Although they were primitive. There weren't really other films. There were some other films like Cinema Newsreels actually were very like them, because Cinema Newsreels were made by photographing the pictures first and then writing the voiceover afterwards, which was possibly the only experimental thing about my films. And I'll show you a bit of one of these films. How we do? That's all good. I'll show you the beginning of the film. What's doing? This is from a film that was finished in 1986, after an awful long time in neglect, a long period of neglect. It was finally finished. And it's kind of a travelogue.
Powerlessness that events have become opaque to me. It is as inconceivable that anything should ever happen as that I should become aware of my own non-existence. On the North Shore, the convalescent is well suited. The sun warms from behind and does not dazzle. The wind blows away my words, and separate behind the face, I turn my eyes inward on the mind. In and flooded the Straits of Dover, it was at once established that the land to the north became the south of England, and that to the south, the north of France. Nowadays, steps would be taken to prevent such erosion, but it's all the same. Boundaries make opposites of neighbors, just as you are to the left of your neighbor to the right, and as in any train of thought, the end of one is followed by the beginning of the next. The movement of goods across such frontiers is administered from the headquarters of the EEC in Brussels. I should tell you of a dream which continually besets me with these several notions. There is a disease, a project, an obligation, a threat, a superstition, and a helmet. As it is my usual practice to sleep out on park benches, I frequently awake early and in unfamiliar surroundings. One of these defenders of our Western freedoms has offered to give me a lift.
There you go. That's enough of that. You see what I mean about the dots? Or maybe you don't. The significance of this film for me was not that it took so long to make, but that it was the difficulty with making a film like this is that if you have a shortage of footage, now yes, that's what I want to say. This film was made inadvertently shortly after finishing editing another film, and me and my partner set out on a European journey. And I took 8 rolls of 16mm negative with me and a clockwork camera, thinking something might come of it. But not that. And when we got to Zurich, I think we photographed about 4 of the rolls, and I got one of them processed, and it looked okay, so I thought, well, I might as well make another film. But when we got to Rome, the camera jammed, and we ran out of film, and I sort of made occasional, slightly, not very strong efforts to buy another roll or another 2 rolls. I couldn't find any. So I had 800 feet. And 800 feet of film is about, well, it's not much longer than the film. So I think this film consists of about 75% of the material photograph. And nowadays you wouldn't worry about that because with electronic images and electronic cameras, lots of footage, it doesn't really matter. As soon as one pressed the button on this camera, one was immediately under pressure to take one's finger off it. to avoid using up too much footage. And this meant that the individual takes are quite short. And when it came to write something, which by this time I got into the habit of doing, it was very difficult to write anything in, say, kind of 6 seconds that wasn't just nonsense. And most of it is nonsense, but it's kind of quite carefully crafted nonsense. And so for me, this was a kind of breakthrough, because the previous films had all involved kind of not very many very long takes. The previous films were made with electric cameras. This was made with a clockwork camera. And it produced a technique, which I then got a bit ambitious about. And a few years after that, I managed to get myself into a position to make a feature-length film. I should explain that in those days, in the 80s, there wasn't really much of a culture of artists moving image. There were memories of a culture of artists moving image in the 70s. And some of those people were teaching, but they weren't tending to attract a lot of imitators. In the 80s, well, I shouldn't generalize, but it wasn't clear where, if anywhere, this kind of thing belonged. And I was kind of tagging on the end of film festivals, mostly. That film was shown in an exhibition at Serpentine. But it wasn't like now, in that there wasn't a large contingent of artists. Well, maybe there isn't now either, actually, but we can ask them about that. So I was looking for a bit of job security, apart from anything else. I was still teaching a bit. But the idea of getting funded to make a low-budget theatrical release was very attractive, because it meant full employment for about 3 years, I think. The result of this, there was a logic to this film. The film is called London, and it's probably the best known of all films that I've ever known, at least in London. The logic was, well, you can't go on trips. If you want to make a long film, you can't go on a trip because you can't afford it. You can't go away for a year because you couldn't come back and do a year or 2 days a week. So you might as well make a film about where you are. And this was, I always found London a very difficult camera subject, which is one of the reasons the trips have got into the films in the first place. But I thought, well, maybe that's good, and you should confront this problem. So the film, it was really, the challenge of the film was whether one could make a film about London at all. And I'll show you the beginning of the film. The slide is a bit, I mean, it's quite a long film, it's 85 minutes long, so I'll just show you the very beginning to give you an idea of what happened. One of the things that happened was that films, as well as getting longer, they got wider. So I got back almost to my 35-minute colour slides. Which may or may not be, well, it seems significant at the time. Anyway, here we go. Full screen. That map, by the way, well, I'll tell you about that afterwards. I could have cut the credits off. Is it going? Is it moving? Probably not.
It is.
There we go. Yeah. So this is supposed to be silent.
It is a journey to the end of the world. It is 7 years since I last saw Robinson on the day I left England when he saw me off at the quayside. I have heard from him from time to time during my travels, but now he's written that he urgently wishes to see me,
that he's on the verge of a breakthrough in his investigations, and that I should come as soon as possible before it is too late. Dirty old blighty, undereducated, economically backward, bizarre, a catalogue of modern miseries, with its fake traditions, its Irish war, its militarism and secrecy, its silly old judges, its hatred of intellectuals, its ill health and bad food, its sexual repression, its hypocrisy and racism, and its indolence. It's so exotic. So homemade. I have arrived as ship's photographer on a cruise ship in which the berths cost £4,000 a week. Robinson lives in the way that people were said to live in the cities of the Soviet Union. His income is small, but he saves most of it. He isn't poor because he lacks money, but because everything he wants is unobtainable. He lives on what he earns in 1 or 2 days a week teaching in the School of Fine Art and Architecture of the University of Barking. Like many autodidacts, he is prone to misconceptions about his subjects, but as there is no one at the university to oversee him, his position is relatively secure. Robinson reads Montaigne. It is good to be born in depraved times, for by comparison with others, you are reckoned virtuous at little cost. Apart from his academic work, Robinson hardly ever leaves the flat except to go to the supermarket. When he used to visit friends abroad, his social life was transformed. He became an enthusiastic flaneur, astonishing his hosts with his stamina and generosity. But for several years, he has not left the country as he wrestles with what he calls the problem of London.
Now, this character was invented to enable this kind of film to deal with subjects, to be about something. The previous film, as you might have noticed, was not particularly, it was about fiction, apart from anything else. This is also fiction, but it's fiction, it's a kind of, it's fiction about someone who is dealing with a what the film calls a problem. And the problem of London, for the protagonist, to oversimplify it, is that it wasn't Paris, or wasn't like he thought Paris used to be, perhaps, is a better way of putting it. So I devised this this way of distancing the narration from the opinions of the protagonist, by moving the narration into the third, moving the protagonist into the third person. The film is about someone else. The film is narrated by a narrator. He's telling you about someone else. He's not telling you about his own. He's not really relaying his own opinions, which seemed to be a viable proposition. And the film, the irony of the film is that all the things that the narrator doesn't like about the protagonist doesn't like about that. The impossibility of a certain sort of urban experience, which is the kind of urban experience I think I had come across in the Surrealist Perception of Paris. The impossibility of that in London, in the mind of the fictional protagonist. This was about to be ameliorated by what happened to London in the 90s to some extent, which is possibly why the film was moderately successful at the time. It seemed to strike a chord, and on the strength of it, I set out to make another one. This film was about, I mean, none of what's, this film doesn't really, what this film discovered for me was that it is possible to make a film about London, which is, you know, well, I mean, obviously, it isn't, but I didn't think I'd be able to do it. So in that sense, there was a problem, and in that sense, the film answered the question, or resolved the problem. But the it didn't really tell me anything new about the city that I hadn't already figured out. And it didn't tell me anything new that wasn't current in a lot of architectural discourse in the 80s and 70s, this being the period of the revival of what you might call urbanism. But the subsequent film did seem to find out something, certainly that I didn't know, which was something about the UK's economy. The next film was an exploration of the economic geography of England outside London. And the map, this is a map made, I made this as a DVD menu for a DVD that I didn't have to make because the BFI released the film on DVD. So this is a redundant DVD menu. The numbers are in chapters, but it gives you an idea of where the film went. The next film was much more premeditated in its meanderings, in that it followed this, approximately followed this diagram. It starts in Reading, reasons which won't become. It starts in Reading because that's Rambaud's last known address in England before he went back to France. Arthur Rambaud. It goes down the Thames and then it jumps back to Reading, and then it follows very approximately this circuitous, this sort of mystic symbol across England. And so it was, to some extent, it was much more planned and advanced than the previous film, although the subjects, the camera subjects, weren't necessarily planned, just the route was planned. And it was undertaken in a series of two-week campaigns. But I'll show you a bit near the beginning and a bit near the end. This is
May the 4th was the day of the local elections. Despite the poor air quality, we set out for a walk in the Bluebell Woods towards Henley and came across a group of satellite dishes at a location we've been asked not to name, which are the television receivers for the BBC's World Monitoring Service a few miles away at Caversham Park, established during World War II. With the coincidence of the Tory election defeats and the VE Day anniversary, there was a lot of talk about the 1945 election and how laissez-faire had been kept off the political agenda until those who participated in the war at decision-making level had departed from the scene. Robinson says that unless Labour wins a landslide victory in a general election, there is always a Conservative majority in England.
This was photographed in 1995.
Henley is the constituency of Michael Heseltine, then the President of the Board of Trade. It was twinned with Baroma, Somalia in 1981. As we walked back to Reading, we passed the preparations for a celebration bonfire. Robinson told me that he'd received instructions from our employer and that the next day we would begin the first of seven journeys that were to be the basis of our project. This method had been suggested by his reading Daniel Defoe's tour through the whole island of Great Britain, which is based on Defoe's travels as a spy for Robert Harley, the government minister in the reign of Queen Anne. The narrative of Britain since Defoe's time is the result of a particularly English kind of capitalism. With our contracts and expense account agreed, we set out to follow the Thames downstream to the sea.
And some months later,
on the evening of the 11th of October, we arrived in Redcar. British Steel's plant at Redcar is one of the four major steel works in the country. It produces 70,000 tons of steel a week, 70% of which is exported, much of it to the Far East, and employs hardly any people. The steel industry's current export surplus is about £750 million. Wilton is one of the biggest chemical production sites in Europe. It produces about 40 intermediate products. The chemical industry's export surplus is about £4 billion. The service sector's share of exports has declined since 1960 as a result of the near extinction of the merchant shipping fleet. The Tees is the UK's biggest single port. It imports iron ore and coal and exports oil and petroleum products. Unemployment in Middlesbrough is 17%, the highest in the country, which has the least regulated labour market in the industrialised world, and the highest prison population of any country in Europe. We stopped to watch the Queen arrive at the Samsung site at Wynyard Park. With £58 million of government aid, Samsung have invested £450 million in a plant which employs between 500 and 600 people, producing microwave ovens and computer monitors. There was a small demonstration by the Committee to Defend Socialism in South Korea. Wynyard Park is the estate of Sir John Hall, the developer of the Gateshead Metro Centre. He bought it in 1987 for £3 million from the Marquess of Londonderry, whose family were formerly coal owners, and has developed golf courses, housing estates, and a hotel, which was not the one we stayed in. In the morning, we travelled south to Shandy Hall. Here dwelt Laurence Sterne, many years incumbent of Coxwold. Here he wrote Tristram Shandy and The Sentimental Journey, died in London in 1768. Near Harrogate, we passed the US National Security Agency's installation at Menwith Hill. This is the largest signals intelligence base in the world and eavesdrops telephone and other communications, some of the most sensitive of which concern the exploitation of Buckminster Fullerenes. Robinson is beginning to act strangely.
Now, the difference between this film and the other one was that this film did seem to discover something, that it set out with a received view of particularly English kind of capitalism that was mentioned in the first clip. And by the end of the film, that view has changed, and that the received view was one of industrial decline. Whereas by the end of the film, the end of the film seems to have, the film seems to have uncovered something rather different, which is the suspected industrial decline isn't actually industrial decline, and all the symptoms of industrial decline, or all the symptoms that have been ascribed to industrial decline, are actually not the result of industrial decline, but are the result of political decision making. Manufacturing industry in the mid 90s was in surprisingly good condition. It's just that it had shed a lot of jobs, but it had shed a lot of jobs not because of decline, but because of automation and mechanization. Probably quite a few people knew that, but it wasn't really a widespread perception. And this encouraged me to think that this kind of filmmaking could function or be in some way validated as a kind of research. This proved to be the route forward to make more of this kind of work. Most recently, a film which is the sequel to that film, which is called Robinson in Ruins. The map for Robinson in Ruins, the third film, is possibly the most wayward of the three, in that it's the least planned of the three, in that it set out to address a question which wasn't really located anywhere. And the question it set out to address was, the issue it set out to address was a perceived discrepancy between ideas about mobility and displacement. Critical and cultural attention afforded to displacement and mobility, and the tendency to fall back on ideas about settlement and belonging that derive from an agricultural past. So there seemed to be an inconsistency in a lot of discussion about, this is about 10 years ago now, between an idea that in quotes, we're all migrants, and on the other hand, if pressed, people do start to talk about belonging. This seemed to me to be something worth looking into. I looked into it by trying to locate the origins of the idea that England developed as a capitalist economy because there was a tradition of freedom of movement, which it turned out wasn't really the case. But in doing so, I performed a kind of perambulation through parts of the south of England, which you see on this map. If you follow the numbers, they're kind of months. And there was, apart from these two preliminary excursions here and here, the line is a notional route. Imagine someone is camping over a long period, is moving along this line. And the dots are camera subjects. So the line doesn't join up the dots, but the dots are accessed from kind of stations along the line. It wasn't really planned, but it turned out to be a clockwise circuit, starting in Oxford, going down to Newbury, and along the ridge, east of Newbury, to Aldermaston and Green and Common places, and then back, following the pipeline, back up to here, where it reached this road, which seemed significant for one reason or another. And then it stops, it gets to a destination here. But I'll show you where there is a discovery made, and the discovery was of a particular place where there had been an agrarian rising in the past, which was a rising against an enclosure, which seemed to have something to do with this business of freedom of movement and mobility and displacement as part of the history of the UK. But I'll just show you the beginning of the film, and then I think maybe I should stop and see if you've got any questions. So this is the beginning. This is kind of setting the agenda for this film.
When a man called Robinson was released from Edgecote Open Prison, he made his way to the nearest city and looked for somewhere to haunt. The house had once been a hotel and was not far from the river. For a few weeks, he dared go no further than the city's outskirts. He believed that he could communicate with a network of non-human intelligences that had sought refuge in marginal and hidden locations. They were determined to preserve the possibility of life's survival on the planet and enlisted him to work on their behalf. In the library, he photocopied Jameson's anticipation of the crisis. It seems to be easier for us today to imagine the thoroughgoing deterioration of the earth and of nature than the breakdown of late capitalism. Perhaps that is due to some weakness in our imaginations. He was equipped with an ancient cine camera with which he made images of his everyday surroundings. From a nearby car park, he surveyed the center of the island on which he was shipwrecked. "The location," he wrote, "of a great malady that I shall dispel in the manner of Turner by making picturesque views on journeys to sites of scientific and historic interest."
Now, the great malady, you might recall, also features in the first clip, and where it says, "the great malady, horror of home," which is a quote from Baudelaire's Journal Intime, and is, in this case, is accompanied by a view over Oxford, the great malady, the centre of the island on which he was shipwrecked, is a view of Oxford, which is a, so the great malady in this context seems to be something to do with, well, I would see it in terms of some sort of transatlantic culture, or possibly what people sometimes describe as Anglo-Saxon capitalism. And the film, this film coincided, the year in which this film was photographed, coincided with the 2008 financial crash. And the film ends, well, the film reaches its destination pretty much around the time of the crash. So there's an attempt to juxtapose these images of historic displacement the centuries, well, since the 16th century, I guess. The agrarian rising I mentioned took place in 1596. It's an attempt to juxtapose the present day, or the then present day economic unfolding with this historical predicament of the English loss of rights to land. Which we haven't really got time. I haven't really, we can't quite show you that in time, but I think I'll stop there because it's now 6:10. If you'd like to ask any questions, please do. Well, possibly, yeah. For some time now, I've tried to be, what I'm trying to do at the moment without, I have to say, very much success, is work out a sequel to the 2008 film, which isn't necessarily another film. But it does involve trying to perceive what's happened since. And the question that I'm asking anyone who will listen is to try and work out. I mean, it seems to me quite surprising that, or it seems to me until. Well, for some years after 2008, it seemed to be quite surprising that the impact of the 2008 crash wasn't much more damaging in the UK. You know, if you look out the window, there are still lots of Range Rovers going past. And unemployment went up, but it didn't go up very much. It didn't go up as much as people expected in most places. And GDP did decline, but it didn't decline by an enormous amount. And when 2008 occurred, it seemed to me, briefly, that the whole economic orthodoxy of the previous 30 years was disgraced. And one thought, briefly, that everyone accepted that it was disgraced. But it wasn't very long before people started to try and restore business as usual. And business as usual clearly hasn't been restored. But on the other hand, the situation is not yet as dire as one might have thought it would be. So what's happened to Middlesbrough? Now, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the plant is mothballed, isn't it?
Yeah,
has it been demolished?
A couple of years ago, the government chose to save the Wales plant over the one in Teesside.
Yeah.
And now we outsource the steel from Germany.
Yeah. Yes, but what's happened to the plant?
It's not completely closed.
Sorry?
It's completely closed. There's a couple of slag mines.
Does anybody own it?
I think it might be ICI still. I think it might be actually a Chinese firm. Someone still owns it, but it's just completely off.
Tata sold it.
It was sold a few times.
Yeah. But I got the impression it was quote mothball.
Yeah, there is still it's closed completely, but there is people keeping certain parts of it alive,
yeah,
just in case.
Yeah. Do you think there's any likelihood that if Labour won the election, they would reopen it?
I think it would be too expensive.
Would it?
Yeah, I think parts of the plant that would be needed are in ruin now.
Yeah. Once you turn it off. That certainly would be one place to go, yeah. Yes, but I'm not convinced that the question is, what I'm trying to do, what I have been trying to do, is to work out not what's happened since 2008, but what we're all living on. Because the question arises, you know, what does the UK's economy consist? I don't know. I don't know how it works. I've got a vague idea how it works. And occasionally one comes across a quotation. There's a quotation, something Orwell wrote in 1945, which is quite suggestive. In a letter, he used to write London letters. He used to have a thing called London Letters. It was sent to the Partisan Review, which was a left-wing periodical in the United States. And his penultimate London letter includes the sentence, "The chief danger of the situation is that the English have never been made to understand that the sources of their prosperity lie elsewhere." And I thought, yes, I think that's probably true, the sources of the, and that's why the current nonsense is so pathetic or comical, because people don't know that. People don't realise the sources of their prosperity, and they, you know, despite everything. I mean, the UK isn't as prosperous as the Tories will tell us, but it is nonetheless relatively, you know, of all countries in the world, it is relatively prosperous. It's about the same level as Italy. It's not as prosperous as France. All this rude stuff you get about France in the mainstream media is all rubbish. You know, French economy is I think probably doing rather better than the British economy. On the other hand, GDP per capita, purchasing power parity, the last time I looked, was higher in the UK than it is in Japan, which was a surprise. The other surprise is how rich they are in Ireland, which is amazing. But the question, you know, what does the UK run on? I don't know what it runs on. I suppose it probably runs mainly on fossil fuel, to be honest. I don't know. But it's got the most appalling current account deficit, which again is hard, it's not often mentioned. The current account, if you, you know, stop me when you've got to know this, but the current account is not merely the trade deficit, so it's not merely the current account deficit, it's not merely the surplus of imports over exports, which is about 30 billion, I think. But it's also, it used to be offset by the surplus of overseas income on overseas investments over dividends and other and interest, etc., paid out on investments here to overseas residents. Recently, for some reason which I don't, I don't know what the reason is, the primary income, the income on investments in and out, has gone into deficit, quite a big deficit. Again, I'm not quite sure why. The other bit of the current account deficit is transfers, which is money paid to the EU, foreign aid, and remittances, people working here, people living here, sending money home to their relatives and so forth. But the transfers isn't very big. The main components of the current account are imports and exports and income on investments, both ways. Last time I looked, this was about 100 billion, which is an unprecedentedly large amount and an unprecedentedly large proportion of gross domestic product. And it's been like that. Well, it hasn't been that big, but the UK last ran a current account surplus in the mid-90s. Curiously enough, when I was making that film, what I didn't realise at the time, when I was making that film, the UK's trade position was actually rather good. And that's why this business of the steelworks is interesting, because, you know, as a southerner, as a southerner living in the south at the time, I was very surprised to learn that about Redcar. I didn't know that the steelworks was successful because one was so conditioned to the idea of job losses and so forth. The thought that these might be partly, if not wholly, caused by technology rather than diminution was a surprise. And in fact, the UK's the steel industry in the past didn't used to export very much. The volumes were much greater, but they were mostly domestic. The consumption was mostly domestic. But in the 90s, the consumption, domestic use of steel consumption dropped, but there was quite a lot of export. And similarly, there were other discoveries of a similar nature about the strength of certain sectors of UK manufacturing. Most of that went under New Labour, it has to be said. By the end of the New Labour period, the trade deficit was pretty much permanent. But it's increasing, and it seems to be increasing even since 2008. So how is that possible? Seemingly the way it's possible, according to the Bank of England, is because there are capital gains, because the current account deficits have to be balanced by capital surpluses, and capital surpluses are loans, so borrowing money from abroad, but also asset sales. And the UK economy is very unusual in the size of its international balance sheet. The international balance sheet, the assets and liabilities are more or less equal. There's a slight, it depends how you value them. So sometimes some people say there's a slight surplus, some people say there's a slight deficit. But they're about six times GDP, so which is very unusual. The US is about, I think, 1.5 times. So the UK has got this enormous international balance sheet. And seemingly, according to the Bank of England, the clever people in the City of London are so good at managing this balance sheet that it generates capital gains. And that's, according to them, why it's possible to sustain these current account deficits. I don't know whether that's really true, but it seems to be how the UK gets away with its current account deficit. And it explains why it's so difficult for governments, either because they're not really interested or because it really is a challenge, to operate any kind of industrial policy in this country, which might result in the revival of something like a steel industry. I mean, most countries have a steel industry because it's a strategically important industry for all sorts of strategic purposes. But these sorts of considerations have been considered eccentric in mainstream UK politics for a very long time. The idea that one should have a steel industry just because it's important to have a steel industry isn't really tenable in free market, whatever you want to call it, thinking, neoliberal thinking. But in other countries, that would be the case. To this extent, I mean, that isn't to say that everybody can subsidize their steel industry, but it's much easier in less aggressively neoliberal contexts. So that doesn't really answer your question. But the answer seems to be that it's very difficult to find a way of visualizing the current economic predicament, other than by going around photographing ruins, which is kind of a bit, I mean, if you go to Birmingham, you know, people are talking about how Birmingham's this, you know, wonderful place now. The last time I went to Birmingham, I was on a bus, and you go past one ruined Victorian institution after another. In, you know, somewhere like Moseley, the Moseley Art School. There's an interesting book, actually, about the decline of the region, of the decline of the art school. I've got what it's called. The Art School and the Culture. So that's a very long answer. It doesn't really answer your question. The answer is probably, yeah, but I don't know whether that's the way to deal with it, actually.
Does anyone have one last question?
Hi, thanks for your talk. I was just wondering if you could talk a bit more about the process of making the films. So I was wondering, like, how do you do your research on the architectural sites, and also, like, how much is it that you make the film that you come across certain buildings and sites and then research them, or do you research them first and then go to the sites?
Do I research the sites or do I just find them? Sorry, I should have repeated the first question. I'm repeating the question. Or some part of it. The process, I tend to describe these. Certainly the films of the last 20 odd years, I tend to describe it in terms of their subject matter, which is perhaps disingenuous, because obviously they're not just about that, they're about making pictures. And one has to ask, I don't know if you know, if you can remember the last line of the last clip. Vanessa talks about from a nearby car park, he surveyed the center of the island on which he was shipwrecked, the location of a great malady, which I shall dispel, he wrote, by making picturesque views. Which I shall dispel, he wrote, in the manner of Turner, by making picturesque views of sites of scientific and historic interest. Now, when you write fiction, you don't. When you put words in a fictional character's mind or mouth or pen, you don't actually have to know what they mean. Well, actually, maybe one should, but that would, I don't know, because I'm not, I don't get it often. No one's ever told me you can't. No one ever told me you have to know what they mean. Something like that, you went, well, I wonder what he means by that. How can you dispel a great malady in the manner of Turner? So I go around afterwards looking for justifications of these assertions. And I did find one for that, which is in a chapter of a book called Landscape and Power. It's an essay called Turner and the Representation of England by Elizabeth Helsinger. You might know this book, it's a famous book, Landscape and Power. Anyway, Elizabeth Helsinger writes, Turner's drawings call into question the possibility of an exclusionary sense of landscape as a national possession, reminding us that, in fact, the notions of possession and circulation to which picturesque landscapes refer, those of the spectator as landowner or tourist, are contradicted by new meanings of the same term demanding recognition in the 1820s and 30s. Turner's defaced views depict a contested land. They also point towards the imminent collapse of the very idea of landscape as an adequate representation of the nation. Now, I suppose you could say that Turner was there, he was addressing a great malady, dispelling even a great malady. It's not quite clear what the great malady is, but certainly something is achieved in the view of Elizabeth Helsinger by Turner's picturesque views. So, I'm looking for images, and I'm sometimes looking for them because I have an idea that they might be there, and sometimes because I just find them. And the best ones, the last ones, I sort of had an idea they were there because I'd seen them from the train. I'd seen this strange place from the train, but I hadn't actually been there. And it was only when I got there, at the end of the procedure, at the end of this circuit, this supposedly self-organizing or self-determining circuit of this part of Southern England, which you can see as, I mean, exactly an invasion of Salerno, but it was a kind of, it was an idea that this wasn't necessarily a sympathetic landscape that one was exploring. But the camera found its way, one way or another, to this particular site and discovered something. But on the other hand, I had seen it in the train. I hadn't appreciated its significance until I got there. The other film, the previous film, which was made probably more quickly, Robertson in Space, the one which ends in the Northeast. That route was produced by joining up dots on a map. So there were places where I wanted to go, and even images that I'd maybe seen that I wanted to plagiarize or improve or something. But there were camera subjects that I knew were there. But there were an awful lot more that one came across en route, so to speak. So the way that the films work in the main is by establishing a kind of recipe. The important thing is they're not scripted, I think. There's almost nothing. In London, I think there was a paragraph. The curse at the beginning, actually. The opening denunciation, dirty old blighty, that I'd written before, although I wasn't quite sure where I was going to put it. And there's another little bit later on, which I'd written before, but most of it was written after the picture was edited. And that's for two reasons, I think. Firstly, because it's much easier to make a film if you have a script, because you don't find yourself chasing things that are difficult to get. If you go somewhere and you can't get it, you know, there isn't anything that's going to produce an image that you want, then maybe you just don't, you just forget about it and you go to the next place. Having said that, by the time I'd made London, I think I could probably go to most places, and given the sympathetic natural light, I could probably get an image out of pretty much anything, you know, or anything, anywhere I was likely to go. So it wasn't quite as it wasn't quite as much of a response as it might otherwise. There was a bit more determination behind the pictures as one went along. But editing the picture before writing is also quite important, because one doesn't want to leave an image up for longer than it can stand, perhaps. So the writing has to be tailored to the duration of each image, which is the difficult bit. Well, I find that. I think anybody would find that. There aren't many other people who make films like this, because why would anyone bother? There are other films like this, but there aren't many people who do, like you know, even Jennings, Humphrey, I don't know if you're familiar with Humphrey Jennings, who was an English surrealist, who made poetic documentary films in the 1930s and 40s, particularly during the Second World War. And Jennings, his best known film is probably a film called Listen to Britain, which doesn't contain any narration, but the other outstanding film in the war for me, is a film called A Diary for Timothy, in which the narration is written by Ian Forster. So, you know, that's division of labour has its advantages. If you don't do that, I don't do that. I do most of it myself. And it's, one does have to wonder whether it's the right way to do it. It might be better to get someone else. I get other people to do the sound editing, but it's about as broad as it goes. Is that adequate?